All right, welcome back to the channel. I'm going to show you how you can block a lot of malware before it can even potentially make it to your computer. And I'm going to show you how to do that by using something called encrypted DNS. I've already talked about this a little bit in some past videos when I was explaining here earlier this week using Portmaster is you can set up DNS for your entire operating system. And what it does is it basically blocks out a lot of garbage using a lot of block lists. So I'm going to briefly cover what DNS is. I could end up doing like an hour plus long video talking about specifics of DNS. It is a somewhat complicated topic going through all the particulars of it, but I'm just going to focus more on how this stuff actually secures you from an attacker. Now, the first thing we're gonna do, I'm gonna pull up this super advanced drawing that I made here in Microsoft Paint just to help give you an idea of how this stuff works, and then we'll get into the particulars of securing your computer using encrypted DNS. So DNS by default is basically unprotected. Anybody could snoop on your DNS traffic. It's been that way for a long time, and encrypted DNS hasn't really started to become a more talked about topic until here just in the last recent years. So the way that DNS typically works, this is just a basic overview of what it does. So DNS operates as basically the phone book for the internet. So when you want to go to google.com and you go to type that into your browser search bar, it's a lot easier to type in google.com instead of rather having to type in an IP address to go to google.com. That's where the DNS operates as a phone book of sorts. And then you also have to factor in that there's places like Google are going to have a ton of IP addresses also, and you would need to make sure you get the right one. So it's a lot easier to just be able to type in the name Google. So the way this works is when you go type something into a browser search bar, what's actually happening is your browser is sending over a communication to a DNS server. And so when you go send over something like, let's say, google.com to the DNS server, it will return an IP address for your browser to look up. And by the way, for the people who are super tech literate, I'm really, really simplifying this. I'm not going to get into the weeds on all this stuff. But this would come back, and let's say the IP address for Google is 10.10.10.10. Then what your browser can do is forward, or rather go to google.com, then you know, you've got your communications going back and forth between you and Google, and it operates this way for basically every website. Like I said, this is an ultra simplified explanation, but that's really not the point of this video. Now, all of this stuff by default typically operates with plain text. Usually, for a lot of ISPs, is they use their own DNS resolvers. And a lot of times those DNS resolvers are unencrypted, meaning all of that traffic going between your computer and the DNS server, your ISP can see. There's also some other issues that come into play with this, because this is where securing your computer comes in, because when all of this stuff is going through plain text, you're open to multiple attacks like man-in-the-middle attacks. In that case, that would be like DNS spoofing, where you think you're going to one website, but rather an attacker is sitting here in the middle. Let's see if I can make this to where it's not a complete pile of garbage here. So an attacker could sit here in the middle and do what's called DNS spoofing, where they actually redirect your browser to go to something that is not Google. It is actually a spoofed website. All right, that looks terrible, but I'm sure you can follow along. So you have stuff like DNS spoofing, which is a man-in-the-middle attack. You have cache poisoning, and there are also some other issues that you end up dealing with. For example, when I start talking about the filtering aspect, is when you have DNS filtering stuff out, all these garbage websites, you can protect yourself from places that you could go to that are actually legitimate websites that have download links that you could click on and infect your entire computer. This also helps protect you against drive-by downloads. And for those of you that are unfamiliar with drive-by downloads, they're pretty nasty. All you'd have to do is go visit a website that's infected And if it does a drive-by download, you don't have to click anything. You could recognize as soon as you go to the website, hey, this is a bad website, I gotta click out of here. And before you even have the chance, it could drive-by download malware right on your computer. You don't have to click anything. So that's some pretty nasty stuff. There's a ton of different attacks out there. You know, you've got like Trojans, remote access Trojans, boot kits, root kits, all that stuff. But these are just some of the attacks here that you can protect against, like the spoofing, the cache poisoning, the drive-by downloads, all that. So now that we have a basic understanding of how DNS works, when you add encryption, typically this ends up going to your ISP. It could also end up going to Cloudflare or Google. Now, I mentioned in the video talking about Portmaster that there was a test done by some security researchers, and they ended up testing about 130,000 malicious domains, and they're testing to see which DNS providers would actually filter out the garbage. And they put up this was a really good test, and you can see here that, like, for example, Google's public DNS only blocked 0.06% of threats. Cloudflare was only 13%. But then you have stuff like Quad9 and DNSSEC, where you start getting up, you know, Quad9 was 78%, DNSSEC is really good at 94%. So this is where we're gonna start getting into a little more depth. So instead of this traffic going to your ISP, who again, this typically tends to be unencrypted, or it could go to Google and Cloudflare, and there's some privacy issues involved with that. That's, again, separate topic that this video would go into, being at least an hour long if I was gonna explain all this stuff. Instead, what you want is for you to find a reliable, trustworthy, secure DNS provider. So in this case, do your due diligence, but there's plenty to support that, you know, for example, Quad9 is a reliable, protected private DNS resolver that you can use. It blocks out a lot of malware. If it's something you want to use, again, do your due diligence, go read their privacy policy and see if it's something you want to deal with. The nice thing is they're based out of Switzerland, and there's very strong data privacy laws out of Switzerland. So instead of this going to your ISP, let's say you now route this to Quad9. Hopefully you guys can still read this here. This is really high tech. So now this is going to Quad9. So all of this traffic is being encrypted. Let's see if I can draw a padlock here. So now all of this traffic is being encrypted. And the other benefit that you get with using stuff like Quad9 or any really sort of reputable secure DNS provider is you also get something called DNSSEC, which is DNS security extensions. And that will help protect against attacks like cache poisoning. Now, I've got to point out, nothing is ever 100% safe. Obviously, encrypted DNS, DNSSEC, all this stuff, it's not foolproof. There's ways that attackers can get around this stuff, but just by you turning this stuff on, you're going to be a hell of a lot more secure with your computer. So the big purpose of DNSSEC is that it basically verifies, it has a whole verification process that you are actually getting the correct DNS that you're going to get forwarded to, so it can prevent stuff like the cache poisoning. And the whole point of using something like encrypted DNS, these are two separate things. They work in tandem, they're symbiotic, and any reliable good DNS provider, encrypted DNS provider, should have both encrypted DNS and DNSSEC. The encrypted DNS will encrypt that traffic, which takes away the ability for an attacker to do the man-in-the-middle attack and spoof it. So, besides protecting against those attacks there, I've also mentioned that you can block out a lot of garbage. This is where, you know, stuff like Quad9 and DNSSEC come into play, where they have what's called basically threat intelligence partners. So your threat intelligence partner would gather a bunch of data. Okay, these are malicious domains. These domains are hosting malware. You can see some of it. Let me show you an example of some of the stuff. So DNSSEC you can use, for example, they've got a few different things. You have just your regular DNSSEC, and then they've got something called Zero. And you can see they protect against quite a bit of stuff here. You know, if you're gonna go with the ultra secure version, it protects against things like typo squatting. So for example, that would be like Twitter or Google, where if you go to type that into a search bar and you transpose, like, let's say a letter or something, it could go to a malicious domain and you might not catch it right away. Let's say you don't catch it and you go and put your login credentials. Now hackers have access. They can go and steal your account. They could do all sorts of stuff. So that's like typo squatting. That's obviously very good protection to have. Then you've got stuff like newly registered domains. That would be something that was like registered within the last 30 days. You know, it could be completely legitimate, or, you know, it could be someone that's hosting a bunch of garbage on their website. It protects against things like cryptojacking. It protects against a whole lot of different stuff. Now, they get all of this through their threat intelligence partners, and you can see here on DNS Zero who some of their partners are. It was actually started by the people that founded NextDNS. But then you've got all these different threat intelligence people who, they collect all this info. Okay, these are all of the bad IP addresses, bad domains, all that kind of stuff. So what you're doing when you enable encrypted DNS, you know, again, you could use something like Google Public DNS or Cloudflare for families. It's still better than nothing, because if you're doing encrypted DNS and you've got DNSSEC in there, it's gonna protect you against some attacks. But what we're looking to do is go way beyond that and add a whole ton of protection for basically no extra added cost. Now, one thing to keep in mind is with something like Quad9 or DNS0, because it blocks much stuff, there is a chance that something legitimate could end up getting blocked. I've used these services for a long time. I've never really had any issues with the DNS side of it. But you do need to have a little bit of tech savvy enough that if a website that you know is supposed to work, that you know is legitimate, ends up getting blocked, it could potentially be this, and that's where you would end up needing to turn off your DNS server if that's what you're using to see if maybe it would be allowed. But again, I've used tons of websites. I have almost never had issues with the DNS filtering on that. The one thing that I think you're gonna run into a lot of troubles with is if you use something like DNS Zero, which blocks a ton of stuff, you could end up blocking something. There's a higher chance of blocking something legitimate than if you're using something like Quad9, just because the filter lists on a service like this are much more restrictive. Now, there are some other options available. Another really good one is NextDNS. There's also Control-D. NextDNS is free to an extent. Control-D is also free to an extent. If you want to start customizing it and customize your actual block lists, you do have to make an account, so there is a privacy factor to consider there. But that's where you can really start to customize what it is that you do or do not want to block. These are just set and forget. You point your browser, or you point your operating system, or you can even point your router to these services. And once you do that, it's set and forget. You don't have to do anything else. So now that we've talked about how all this stuff blocks a lot of this garbage out, how it can protect you from even getting to a malicious website, there are a few different ways you can set this stuff up. I talked in the Firefox video about how you can set it, and you can do this from any browser. You go to the security settings, you look up the DNS settings. Every one of these sites will have ways to set up and how to configure this stuff. So if you, here on DNS Zero, for example, if you go to browsers, it will tell you what you need to do in your browsers in order to turn on encrypted DNS. Same for Quad9, it's got installation instructions, it's got it for setting it at the operating system level. Now, what I would recommend is that you do this at the, you could do it at the router level if you want to. What I would typically recommend is that you do it at the operating system level, or you could just stick to your browser. Now, the way that you would do that from the operating system level, there's different things you can use, like NextDNS has their own application that loads in and protects all your operating system DNS requests from the operating system level, so all your browsers would be protected. You can use something like Yoga DNS. This is a pretty popular service. This will let you configure encrypted DNS, or you can also use something I talked in a previous video talking about, Portmaster. This is a great service. This gives you a firewall plus encrypted DNS, and it's even got quick settings. So if you were to come in here, you could select their preset stuff, or you could load in your own. You could load in your own block lists, like DNS Zero, for example, or Control-D. So when you set this stuff up, then what it will do is it will just start blocking all that stuff by default. So let's say you go and type in a, let's say you want to go to a file repository service, and there's, let's say, 100,000 different download links on there. I don't recommend anyone use something like a file repository service, but let's say you go to one thinking it's legitimate. As long as that thing is in the block list, or you try to go to a malicious website that you don't know is malicious and it tries to do a drive-by download, when you have something like Quad9 enabled where it's got that block list set up for that website or the IP address, whatever it is, it will block before you even have a chance to go there. So what you're seeing with how I'm explaining all this stuff is, what you're seeing is a lot of this stuff won't even make it to your computer. You don't even have to take the chance that your antivirus might miss it and you get a virus on your computer. Now again, nothing is foolproof. There's nothing that's ever 100% secure. This is all part of that layered approach that I've been talking about throughout all these, this video series on cybersecurity. But this alone, just this one thing, this can account for a ton of protection for your computer. Now there's obviously other things, like, you know, you've got to make sure you're being smart. You're not doing something like some random person sends you an attachment and then you open it. That's how a lot of infections happen on computers. There's still plenty of other ways that you can get infected. But if you are using secure DNS with a filter list, as you can see here from this research that was done by the security researchers, I'll drop a link down below so you can go read it in your free time if you want to. As you can see, when you're using some of these services, you get a ton of protection and it just blocks all this garbage out by default. Anyway, that's going to wrap the video up. I'll probably do some more in-depth stuff on this at some other time. Like I said, a full in-depth dive on DNS would really probably take at least an hour to explain through all the particulars of it. I just wanted to cover how this can protect your system. If you like it, make sure you go and drop a comment. Let me know what else you want to see for cybersecurity stuff or just computer stuff in general. And I will see you in the next video.